Thank you, Charlie. Okay, so now we have been seeing speech recognition, speaker recognition, and now machine translation. So you are changing from topic to topic. First of all, most of the slides, the content of this talk is taken from these blogs in NVIDIA that you can have a look. They are really nice. Again, previous concepts from this course are the same as before in the language modeling. Recurrent neural network, words embeddings, and in this case, language modeling, okay? So lots of things that I'm going to say, they are already explained, but let's talk a little bit about the context of machine translation, okay? Machine translation is the application that is able to translate from a source language to a target language. It has been done from different perspectives. Here we have this backwards pyramid, the classical one, that how you can approach this machine translation. You can go either directly from the source text to the target text with a corpus-based approach like the example-based. You can go in the middle doing a transfer-based approach. That would be the rule-based system that I'm going to talk in the next slide. And then you have the interlingua. Until now, this interlingua was created manually. So there was this, for example, the Esperanto language, that it wanted to be an interlingua among all languages. And the idea is that you analyze the source text with rules, with morphology, knowledge, and all this. You transform it into the interlingua, and from the interlingua you go into the target text. The rule-based system, which is a transfer-based, is this one in the middle. It's just you do some morphology and simplification of the source language, syntactic simplification, and then you have a set of rules manually done, and then you generate the final language. This is a very expensive approach. I mean, in terms of hours dedicated, normally rule-based systems have to be computed during years to work well. But, well, they did really well. In fact, when I was working in Singapore, they said, we have the rule-based system to sell, and we have the statistical-based system to publish. Okay, the good point of the rule-based system is that you know the errors where they come from. You can change that rule that causes the error of the translation. You know exactly how to interact with the system. With a statistical-based approach, which is trained on parallel corpus, I'm going to talk about this. This tracing of the error is more difficult, no? But this is the system that has been working for the last, I don't know, 15 years or more. The idea is that you have a parallel corpus at the level of sentence. You have the source sentence and the target sentence. And you compute a word alignment between this. You have the parallel sentences and you compute a word alignment. You align word by word. Again, by counting. Okay, by co-occurrences. So if a lot of times has appeared comprar in the Spanish sentence and in the corresponding parallel sentence it has appeared by, comprar and by will be aligned. Then with this word alignment you do a phrase extraction, okay? You extract kind of patterns, sequences of words that are the translation of each other, and you build the translation model. Then you build the language model. We have talked about this with an n-gram-based model normally. And you combine these models, these models are combined in the decoding, which together with the sentence that you want to translate, finds the most probable target sentence. Okay? So this is what is state of the art, still state of the art. Why do we want a new approach, a totally different paradigm? Well, the rule-based approach, you need years to develop this kind of approach, so I mean, it's difficult. And regarding the statistical systems, we have this word alignment and translation model, for example, optimized separately, so they are not integrated. Translation is at the level of words, which poses problems with languages that are, for example, morphologically different. For example, Chinese has no morphology and Spanish has a lot of morphology. To go from Chinese to Spanish is really challenging. And also translation is done by language pairs. So going back to the idea of interlingua, we are not considering interlingua anymore in the sense of doing human-computed interlingua by rules and all this. But the idea of interlingua is nice because you have less translation systems needed. In a highly multilingual environment like the European Union, for example, if you compute statistical systems pair by pair, you have like 25 official languages or whatever, per 24, that's the number of systems that you have to compute. With an interlingua, this is reduced to 2 per the number of languages, no? So the idea of interlingua, it's very nice. So it would be nice to compute an automatic interlingua. So these are the reasons why we want to use neural machine translation. We want an integrated machine translation paradigm, not word aligned translation modeling and having lots of features there. Maybe we want to train at the subword or at the character level so that this morphology thing is not a problem anymore. And we want this automatic interlingua. Maybe it's possible with a neural machine translation. So, okay, what do we need to train the neural machine translation? Exactly the same that we need with these statistical systems. We need a parallel corpus, huge amounts of parallel corpus. That is the sentence, for example, if we want to translate from English to Russian, the sentence in English and the sentence in Russian. We have sources of this parallel corpus. We have the European Plenary Parliament speeches, the Canadian Hansard, the United Nations, the Common Crawl. We have large databases, so this is not a problem. Maybe it's a problem for some language pairs, for example, I don't know, Chinese, Catalan. You don't have parallel corpus for that, but well, there are lots of pairs that you have. And well, we have these international evaluation campaigns that they provide the corpus, and lots of groups can train with the same corpus and compare their systems. So this is nice. What else do we need apart from the parallel corpus? We need automatic measures so we can optimize our system. We can see how good is our system, because I mean, human evaluation, it's nice, it's really nice, but it's expensive, no? So we cannot optimize with human evaluation. We need automatic measures. For example, here I show the example of the BLEU, that it's a standard measure in machine translation, that you compare sequences of n-grams. You have the translation output, and you compare how many sequences of words match the reference, okay? The reference is a correct translation of the sentence you are translating. And here the same requirements than the phrase-based system. Okay, so neural machine translation did not appear, well, what first appeared, sorry, here I am wrong, what first appeared was in the late 90s, there was this early neural machine translation approaches, as Adrian mentioned, that happened for speech recognition. It happened the same for neural machine translation. There were some approaches in the late 90s that proposed an integrated neural network. to train a machine translation system. The problems that were faced there were the same as in speech recognition. There were no large amounts of data. There were computational capabilities that we have now. The same, but in 2006, for example, there was this first integration of language modeling, neural language modeling into statistical machine translation. So the first integration were using neural networks in the statistical machine translation approach, either in the language model, either in the translation, to smooth the translation model. And then just 2-3 years ago, in 2013-2014, it appeared this neural network integration, that neural network machine translation, the change of paradigm. And in 2015, it was shown to be a state of the art. Okay, so just 1 year after appearing, it was a state of the art. So here you have the main architecture of this system. Again, it's a sequence to sequence, so it's similar to the language modeling. It's like, what we have here is two recurrent neural networks. No, we have the source sentence uses a recurrent neural network to compress the source sentence into a context vector, and then this context vector uses another recurrent neural network to go to the target language, to the target language. Okay. And well, here in the side view you have more specified the steps: the one of K encoding, the continuous word representation, the recurrent neural network in the encoding, the recurrent neural network in the decoding, and the steps back. Okay, so let's go into detail. The encoder. The steps are this. You know, the one-hot encoding. I'm going to skip this because this is the third time that you see it. You have the projection of this one-hot encoding into the continuous space. And then what you have is the recurrent neural network that compresses this continuous word representation into one single context vector. Okay, this recurrence is normally done with long LSTMs, gated recurrent units, again, not with a naive recurrent neural network. As for the decoder, what we do is computing the, in fact, is the reverse we have done with the encoding, we do it with the decoder. To compute the internal state of the decoder, this depends on the summary vector that we have, the context vector that we have, the previous output word, and the previous internal state. Okay? With this this new internal state, we score each word in the vocabulary with a dot product given by this hidden state. And here, if we forget about the bias, we get a higher score if the word vector and the decoder internal state are similar to each other. Because here what we are doing is a dot product, no? So the more parallel are the two vectors, the larger is this score, okay? So that's how a word is more probable. And this score is finally transformed into a probability, because this is scored into a probability, with a softmax layer again, okay? So after computing this, we go back to the first step, we compute the decoder internal state, we score and normalize the target word, and select the next word. This is repeated again and again until we reach the end of the sentence, okay? Until the end of the sentence of the word is predicted. Well, the training of this, so we need to prepare the parallel corpus. Given any pair of from the corpus, that we compute the conditional log probability and the log likelihood of the whole training corpus, and we maximize this log likelihood using a standard optimization algorithms like the stochastic gradient descent, ADAM, and ADA delta, whatever. Okay. Here you have, out of curiosity, the computational complexity of this. So you really need GPUs for this, because I mean, otherwise you cannot train a neural machine translation system. It's like the systems that we are training that are more complex than this one, because they use attention-based mechanism, which I'm going to explain in the next session. Train with a corpus of like the 5 million sentences. They train for 2 weeks, 3 weeks. So just to give you an idea of how long does it take. That's why we didn't propose a machine to build a neural machine translation system in the projects, because it didn't make sense. But well, I can say the response that I can kind of answer to this question, but still I'm going to ask why this might not work. This encoder-decoder architecture might not work. Do you see a problem there? Because, I mean, you are using the entire sentence to compute a context vector, and from this context vector, you are going to the target. So an entire sub-sentence is compressed into a context vector. So sentences might have 50 words, for example. So that's the problem, no? We are encoding the entire sub-sentence into a single context vector. This is, even us as human, we don't use the entire sentence to translate. I mean, we focus into parts of the sentence. So we are translating parts, no? So that's the problem with this. So with the attention-based mechanism that I'm going to explain in the next session, the idea is that you concentrate on different parts of the sentence to do translation and do not compute. You don't do this compression. So, summary is very clear. Machine translation is faced as a sequence-to-sequence problem. The source sentence is encoded into a fixed length vector and decoded into a target. And what you need is pile corpus and an automatic evolution. And that's all. Apart from the blogs, you can look at this lecture note, which it's also chapter 6, talks about neural machine translation. And okay.